it's not just enough to welcome him. You got to give him permission. Come on, say you are welcome. Welcome into this place, oh God. Welcome into this broken. You are. Make me whole, God. 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 Now
have. Oh, somebody say you're welcome, God.
Praise God for another opportunity to come together as a church family and worship. I praise God that we're able to meet again. You know, in this Isaiah 25:1, it reads, O Lord, I will honor and praise your name, for you are my God. You do such wonderful things. You planned them long ago, and now you have accomplished them. So whatever you're going through, whatever God has allowed into your life, remember to give him praise for the good, give him praise for the bad, because in all situations, God is God and God is always good. So we always want to be mindful of that, especially as we go into worship. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you so much for this day, Lord. We thank you for those who are tuning in and are anxious to hear what you have to say to them this morning, dear God. I ask, Heavenly Father, that you would be with our preacher of this morning, Reverend Keith Bethel, dear God, that he would be used by you, dear Lord, to deliver us a word. I pray for the music ministry, Lord, those who will be ministering in song, those who are handling our AV and PowerPoint and all those things which makes it possible for us to be on the air, dear God. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would have your way. Bind the evil one, dear God. And we pray, Lord, that you would be glorified and you would be lifted up and praised, and that we as a people will be edified. We pray, Lord, that you would take charge of all that proceeds from this moment on. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. I'm glad you're here. And now we're going to be ministered to in song by the music ministry.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
As we start this worship service, we just want to just usher in the presence of God. We just want to call his name during this time that we have right now. We just need to be reminded that he's our strength. He's our peace in the time of need, in the storms that we're going through, anything that we're going through. We just need him to guide our way, light the way for us so that we know where we're going. So just meditate on these words as we sing this song. And just let the Lord speak to you. Amen.
I will worship you,
always,
always.
Into your life that you did not expect, and you don't know how you can make it through. You've lost a loved one. Someone you thought you would spend your whole life with has walked out of your life, and you can't see how God can make anything out of this situation you're in. But I'm here to tell you this morning that we have to remember what God said to us. Jesus said, "I give you a peace that the world can't give to you. I give you a strength that you won't receive from someone else." God is speaking into your life, into your situation, and he wants you to understand that he alone is God. He alone is your provider. He alone can meet your innermost needs, and he wants you to glorify him this morning. He wants you to praise him this morning. I wish I could take off around this sanctuary. I wish I could speak in 1,000 tongues and it still wouldn't be enough to glorify my God and Savior. He's a good God, and he loves you, and he's going to provide for you. He's going to comfort you in your time of need. We just need to worship him. Worship him. Even when it talks about our tithes and offerings, it talks about worshiping him with what he has given to us. And he has blessed you this week, and he has provided for you this week, and he has kept you this week. And we need to praise him in this place. Wherever you are, whatever you're feeling, whatever you're going through, glorify God for what you have right now. Look around your room. Look around the things that God has provided and say, "Thank you, Lord." Think about how he has kept you for another day, how he is changing you, how he's moving in you. When you look back over your life, you know there are things that you are ashamed of, but God loves you anyway. God blesses you anyway. And if you don't have anything else to praise him for that. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory to you, Most High God. Bless your holy name. He's a good, good, good God. I ask that you would join me in our scripture for reading for today. And our scripture reading is from the book of Obadiah. We'll be reading chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, starting at verse 1. The vision of Obadiah. Thus says the Lord God concerning Edom, "We have heard a report from the Lord, and a messenger has been sent among the nations saying, 'Arise, and let us rise up against her for battle.' Behold, I will make you small among the nations. You shall be greatly despised. The pride of your heart has deceived you, you who dwell in the clefts of the rocks, whose habitation is high. You who say in your heart, who will bring me down to the ground? And verse 4, though you ascend as high as the eagle, and though you set your nest among the stars, from there I will bring you down, says the Lord. And may the Lord add a blessing to the reading of our word and sanctify it into our hearing. I would like to welcome all of you this morning, our members, but especially those who may be visiting with us. You found this broadcast and God has led you here. We want to welcome you. If we were here in the sanctuary, all of our members would stand and applaud you and show you some love. We wouldn't have put you on the spot and asked you to say anything, but we would have asked you to stand so we could acknowledge you and see who we could be praying for. And so I want to take this opportunity to extend to you the love of Christian Stronghold. We hope that you will be blessed by the service. We hope that you will join us again, and we pray that once the sanctuary is open again, you will come and join us in person. Welcome to our service, and we know you will be blessed. Next Wednesday, October the 14th, and next Sunday, October the 18th, we will still be streaming our services. Please be sure to stay informed of our COVID-19 shutdown updates that you receive each week. And remember that the building is closed, but the Church of God is always open. If you're not receiving your weekly updates, please contact Sister Roxanne Covington at 215-877-1530 at extension 1100. Wednesday, October the 14th, our Wednesday night Bible study lesson is Encouraging Others. And that's lesson 2, Saying the Right Words, the book. On Sunday, October the 18th, Christian Stronghold Choir will be having their virtual anniversary at 8:30 a.m. Christian Stronghold Church is partnering with the Black Doctors Consortium to bring a barrier-free flu clinic and barrier-free COVID-19 test to our church on Thursday, October the 15th, this coming Thursday from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. For more details, check out this week's COVID-19 update. Parents, I'm talking to you who are parents. We, the church, want to be a blessing to your college student while they're away in college. We want to bless them. We want to reach out to them and show them love. All I'm asking for is a little respect. No, all I'm asking for is for you to get some information to me so that we can be a blessing to your children. Even if you've given me the information before, give it to me again. Please, don't make me beg. I was going to do boys and men, get down on bended knee so we can beg, so I can beg you. All I need is your student's name, the name of their college, their address while they're in college. What year are they in? First semester, freshman, second semester, sophomore. Whatever they are, send that to me. I need their email address and phone number. You can send that information to me at khenley, H-E-N-L-E-Y, at christianstronghold.com. Now, it says by Monday the 12th, which is tomorrow, but I understand the demographic I'm dealing with. So I want to extend it to Friday. Please get the information to me. Thank you. Our virtual cells, we want to ask that you will come and join our cells. For more information on how to join a cell, call 215-877-1530, extension 2001. We have some funeral announcements. Jean B. Bruce's daughter passed away, Frances Bruce. She was the mother of Ruth Lewis and the sister of Henry Bruce. Alice Bradley Jones's mother passed away, Sarah McLean. She was the mother-in-law of Reverend Lorenzo Jones. The service will be on Tuesday, October the 13th. viewing at 9 a.m. and the service at 11 p.m. at Philip Temple CME Church, 754 South 3rd Street, Philadelphia, PA. Please note there is a home address correction in your recent COVID-19 update for the Jones family. Thank you. The Mason family would like to thank you, our Christian Stronghold family, for your outpouring of love and the departure of our patriarch, Rayfield Mason Sr. Our hearts are overwhelmed in tears many times over in your many demonstrations of cards, flowers, and monetary gifts, and delicious meals, to name a few. As evidence of your prayers, we had safe travels, harmony, and gratitude of the legacy he left us. We also want to give a shout out to Pastor Richardson. His birthday is October the 13th, so let's wish happy birthday to our senior pastor, Pastor Willie Richardson. Although you're with us by way of online streaming, we still need your financial support. Whatever platform you are using to watch this service, please follow the instructions on how you may give to support our ministry. We also want to remember our speakers envelope. We have a guest speaker this morning, so look for that as well so that we can bless the man of God who's bringing us the word this morning. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 11 to 12, it reads, "Yes, you will be enriched in every way so that you can always be generous, and when we take your gifts to those who need them, they will thank God." So when, as you prepare to give your gifts and offerings to the Lord, understand that that it is to bless not just the people here at Christian Stronghold, but the ministries we have in the community as well. In verse 12, it reads, "So two good things will result from this ministry of giving. The needs of believers in Jerusalem will be met, and they will be joyful and express their thanks to God." And that's what we're always looking for, in opportunities to worship God and praise him in things that we do. As you do your online giving, let me encourage those of you who have been faithful in giving. We praise you. We thank you for what you're doing. The church appreciates it. We're blessed that you have continued your commitment to the Lord by giving your tithes and offerings. For those of you who are not giving, today will be a great day for you to start. God has countless blessings waiting for you by doing the one thing that he has asked us to do. He asked us to worship him and praise him, but to give as well. And I'm praying that you will be able to have enough faith to start doing that even today. If you believe that you don't have enough to give, be encouraged to know that you can start wherever you are. Give a little and watch God work in your life. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for those who gave, those who wanted to give or were unable. We pray, Heavenly Father, for our leaders who handle the finances, dear God, that you would give them the wisdom and insight necessary to handle these funds which have been given to us. We pray that they would be good stewards, dear God, of God's money. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would bless those who gave, bless those who wanted to give, and would move on the hearts of those who still have not been freed up to do this, dear God. Praise you and thank you for all these things. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. And at this time, we will be ministered again in song by the Stronghold Christian Exhortation Ensemble Music Ministry.
Says that we will make it a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path, talking about the word of God, and we will hide its word in our heart. The scripture goes on to say that we might not sin against God, so we need to have that scripture and that word in our hearts. So this song comes from Proverbs 3, talking about writing it on the tablet of our hearts. Amen. Amen. Let's praise him.
Thank you.
write them on us.
Write them on the tablets of your heart.
Come on, let's get some energy, come on. Say, write them on us.
Write them on the tablets of your heart.
Yeah. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me will forever be fruitful indeed. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except that he comes through me. Yeah. Let not mercy
and truth
forsake you. Let not mercy and truth forsake you.
Say
we really ought to
write them on the tablets of your heart.
It only works when we take the word and we really, really, really ought to
write them on the tablets of your heart.
All right, now it's your turn to sing. Say, I am the way.
I am the way.
The truth and the light.
Truth and the light. No one gets to the Father
except if they go through Jesus.
Except that he comes through me.
Orders. Come on, let's go. Come on. Come on. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Trust in the Lord with all your mind. Trust in the Lord with all your heart.
And lean not to your own understanding.
Trust in the Lord
with all your mind.
Trust in the Lord.
opportunity to introduce a good friend of mine. It's a pleasure to be able to do that. Is our own Reverend Keith Bethel. He is a graduate of Moody Bible Institute. He is a great husband, a great father. He's a man of God. And he takes his love of the Lord wherever he goes and instills it in everything he does. He leads several ministries here at Christian Stronghold, and God is already preparing him for his next phase of ministry here at Christian Stronghold. It's been a pleasure over the years to watch God move in his life. As we stood up here as part of Christian Sounds Choir, as 20-somethings, and now to be serving in ministry with him as not 20-somethings. So I'm going to get out of the way. You're going to be blessed. If you've never heard this man of God preach before, you're going to be totally blessed. And I'm looking forward to what God has for us through our own Reverend Keith Bethel.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, Christian Stronghold. You know, the one thing I miss about worship service when it's virtual is that, like, you can't bring the music ministry back. Like, you can't. I'm ready to have them come back up and be like, they had that thing going. So we praise the Lord for the music ministry. We praise the Lord for the opportunity to be with you again. We praise the Lord for his faithfulness to us as a congregation. So thankful for our pastor, Pastor Richardson, for him and for Sister Pat. We continue to pray for them and pray the Lord watch over them. And thankful for Pastor Bell and for his leadership of the ministry. And really excited to be with you this morning for one more opportunity to share with you what the Lord has laid on my heart. You know, I've been working through these pieces of the minor prophets, and we've looked at a bunch of them so far. And the one thing the Lord has shown me is that he speaks so clearly about who he is and how he acts and behaves, the attributes of who God is. And as we get closer to those, how he wants to draw us into those. So I pray you join me now in a word of prayer, and we'll launch into it. And we'll look today at the book of Obadiah, a little tiny book with a powerful message. Eternal God, we love you and we thank you. Lord, mighty is your hand, but so great is your grace towards us. God, you are awesome. And in glory and power, you reach down and you touch us, Father God. You are gentle towards us and humble in your spirit, Lord. Lord, I pray that today you would humble us. That you would quiet our hearts and that you would, Lord, sift through the way we act and behave and help us to walk away from your word today. Lord, changed, empowered, and transformed. Father, if I'm honest, I so need your forgiveness. We so need your patience with us. We get it wrong so often. Would you make it transparent to us in our own lives? Would you convict us in our hearts, Father God, that not the Lord, we would walk away feeling bad, but that we would walk away wanting more and more of you. For the more desperate my position, the greater I stand in need of you. The more I find myself weak, then the greater I need your perfection. So today, would you speak from your word? Dismiss all that is in me so that you might be seen and glorified. It is your word, your will, and your power. Will you today make the difference? It's in your matchless name that we ask these things. Amen? Amen. So when you're looking at the book of Obadiah, and it's an interesting little tiny, tiny book, 21 verses. But it tells a story of something that I think is really relevant for our time. Something that I think speaks to all of us about who we are and how we act and behave, and speaks a lot about the world's condition. Billy Graham says this: a self-centered indulgence, pride, and a lack of shame over sin are now emblems of the American life. Self-centered indulgence, pride, and a lack of shame over sin are now emblems of an American lifestyle. The world may seem to be many things, but if we pause and we look at it through God's eyes, a lot of what Billy Graham says here is pretty true. Seems to me that the world is full of people who are self-centered and self-indulgence. There's almost an overindulgence in self-focus. We got more my's in our lives than we've ever had. My Facebook, my Twitter, my TikTok, my. Photo shoots of myself. But that small, silly, kind of simple indulgence, that's not maybe bigger self-indulgence. Says no matter what, I have to own the role. My brand is most important. My image, my appearance. And so no matter what I've done, there seems to be no sense of shame. I'm okay with doing whatever I want to do because that's all right. I can shoot somebody in the middle of Fifth Avenue. I still have a right to be who I am. My brand is strong enough. It's this complete lack of, where's the repentance? Nobody repents anymore. Now we just walk it back. I don't have to repent. No. I said some things. They were the wrong thing to say. I know everything about it is wrong. Everything around me, even the world would say it's wrong, but I don't have to get on and say, hey, I'm wrong. I just walk it back. And it may seem like something we see on TV, but beyond on TV, it's happening every day. Well, there's some good news and some bad news about that. See, the reality is this idea of pride and self-indulgence and a prideful heart, well, there's nothing new about it. The world has kind of seen it, done it. We got the T-shirt to remember it. There's nothing new about a white pride movement. Ask Hitler or Mussolini. There's nothing new about fascism. There's nothing new about arrogance. There's nothing new about making myself more important. That's something that the world has held on to for a really, really long time. And so when we step into the 21 verses of Obadiah, there's an ancient story about prideful hearts. See, Obadiah is a story about the nation of Edom. And that name may sound familiar because if you remember Jacob and Esau, the story of Obadiah is generations later, Edom and Israel, brothers by DNA, are the sons of Jacob and Esau. And somebody stop and say to yourself, you know, pride can last for many generations. It can be a generational sin, a generational curse that runs through how we act and behave. And this story tells the story of this prideful nation who sets itself up against the will of God. And sets itself up against the will of what God would have them to do and starts to believe more about who they are and their own strength and their own power. And I think we get into this phase in our own lives, in our own communities, in our families, in which we start to establish ourselves or make ourselves seem bigger than we are. The last thing you want to be in life is on the wrong side of humility before God. And that's where they find themselves. Now, this question around pride, before we get too far, I want to be sure that we clear that is all pride bad? Now, this idea of, I know some of you sitting home, you're saying, hold on. I'm proud of things.
Well, I think it's a worth question, wild question. You see, this picture of you, see, it is a picture of Jesse Jackson. Some of you may recall it. I recall it vividly. It is November 4th, 2012. It's the election of Barack Obama to the presidency of the United States, and that is the picture of Jesse Jackson. It's a picture of pride. See, some pride is wrapping itself up in an achievement that is greater than oneself. It is not about me. That photo is not about Jesse Jackson. It's about what has happened as he, a civil rights leader, having watched and seen God move over generations to arrive at a place where he sees a black man in the presidency of the United States. I think that there's a difference between a humble-like pride, an achievement in a moment, an answer to prayer, a recognition of something that is greater than yourself. That's a moment of pride that you share with the God Almighty. It creates in your heart a sense of humility and a deeper appreciation for who God is and how he acts and behaves. That's a different kind of pride. Unfortunately, that may not be the pride. And we see, it's clear that in the scripture that some pride is okay. It's Ecclesiastes says, and that a man should rejoice in his own works. That's a different type of pride. Different type of rejoicing. But we're talking about this pride, Ezekiel 28:2, in the pride of your heart, you say, I am God, but you're a mere mortal, not a God. See, I am convinced that pride may be the most dangerous sin of all. It's in the heart of the devil that we begin this work of rebellion. It's the sin of witchcraft, and it's the thing that gets into heart and corrupts everything about who we are, and is incredibly deceitful. The one who has a haunting look, a proud heart, him I will not endure. Pride sets us up against God in a battle that we cannot win. And like Edom, at times we can find ourselves so ignorant. That's such a harsh word when you say it. But pride is one of those things that needs a harsh word. First John 2:16 says, for all the world, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but of the world. This idea that pride and the lust of flesh and the eyes all go together, that, and we see it. We see it in the world today, this desire for everything that is sensual and passionate, anything that satisfies me outside of God's will, this need for recognition and financial security and being and placing ourselves, all of that is wrapped up in this ball of pride, and at the end, it sets itself up against God. It is the greatest weapon of the enemy. And he sows it deep into our hearts. And we find it deeply sowed into the nation of Edom. Obadiah 1:1-4. The vision of Obadiah. Thus says the Lord God concerning Edom. We have heard the report of the Lord. An envoy has been sent among the nations, saying, rise, arise, and let's go against her for battle. Behold, I will make you small among the nations. You are greatly despised. The arrogance of your heart has deceived you. You who live in cliffs of rock and loftiness of your dwelling place, who set your heart, who will bring you down to the earth? Though you build high like eagles, though you set your nest among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. So Edom had itself in a secure place. They had taken a high land. They lived up on mountains and cliffs. And so when you have that, your enemy struggles to attack you. And so they've been very successful in protecting themselves. And they were resistant to God's will, which had been set inside of them for generations. Because like their father, who, although tricked, gave away his birthright. They're still fighting the same fight, and they ultimately will attack Israel and work against the will of God. And I want to ask you to do something today. Make sure you don't have any Edomite attitude inside of you. And what you might say to God, well, this isn't me, before you go check out on the message and say, well, I'm not like this, Reverend Bethel. This is not how I act. Before you go check out. See, pride is one of these things that's so deeply deceitful that you can be celebrating your excess and not realize that you're sitting in sin. Edom was like that. So the first thing you need to know is that there's a prophecy about pride, no matter what you think. And the reason you don't want to check out is because whether you know it or not, pride has an outcome. There's a prophecy about what will happen for those who have a prideful heart. Whether you like it or not, it's coming. So the first prophecy about pride is this. The Lord will detest the prideful. There's no question about it. Asked and answered, the Lord will detest the prideful. Proverbs 16, 1 to 4. To humans belong the plans of the earth, but to the Lord, but from the Lord comes a proper answer of the tongue. All a person's ways seem pure to them, but the motives are weighed by the Lord. Commit to the Lord whatever you do, and he will establish your plans. The Lord works out everything to its proper end. Even the wicked for a day of disaster. The Lord detests all proud hearts, but be sure of this. They will not go unpunished. The challenge for the prideful person or the prideful heart, the measure of maybe whether or not you have one, is that typically the prideful heart makes a person feel like they're a superhero. See, the only I kind of behavior. Only I can manage this business or this project. Only I can host a holiday dinner. Nobody makes sweet potato pie like me. Yeah, I know that stepped on some. Yeah, that's okay. Put them toes back underneath that kitchen table. Sip another piece of coffee and let's keep on going. Only I can get it right. Only I can run this ministry. Only I can manage the books. Only I can pay the bills. Only I can drive. We are a whole lot of only I's. It's what happened to the nation of Edom. And only they. See, you plan in your heart a reality that seems pure to you, but it is not. The Proverbs 16:2, all persons' ways seem pure to them, but the motives are weighed by the Lord. And we often struggle to commit our way because we may not like the answer that God gives us. To all humans belong the plans of your heart, but the Lord comes out with a proper answer. So I'm okay with it up until the moment where the answer is going to be different than the one I want. If that's the case, then you may be acting like a superhero. Well, I just stopped in today to tell you a little secret. Superman, Batman. Wonder Woman, the Hulk. The Black Panther, Adam Ant, Mighty Mouse, Donald, I don't care who you call. Let me just say something they all have in common. They're all make-believe. They're all make-believe. You may enjoy the film, may love the superpower, but ain't nobody leaping over tall buildings in a single bound. I know I want to have a Wakanda forever, but it's a fantasy. I'm breaking hearts right now. I know it. There is no man turning green. There's no little mouse to say, here I come to save the day. That ain't happening. There's only one superhero. There's only one who forgives, only one who died, only one who was raised from the dead. There is only one who's going to crack the sky and come back one day. There is but one superhero. We serve and worship at an audience of one, and everything else is just an entertainment, a momentary distraction. He gets all the glory, all the honor. So when we say in our heart of hearts that only we can do it, what we do is we distract from God, his glory, but even more, we pour onto ourselves an anxiety and the stress that we're not fit for. That's why Thanksgiving's so hard on you, because you think you're the only one. That's why the relationship is so hard, because you think only you can fix it. God is looking for a day when we get on bended knee and beg of him to do the things that we need him to do. You want to see the supernatural happen? Ask of God. When we set ourselves up on a hill and we believe in our own strengths, when we set ourselves towards a prophecy, and this is the thing you need to know, although God will forgive you, he will detest you. Don't anyone be confused. The prideful heart is detested by God. So why does your Thanksgiving dinner always end up in arguments and distractions and evilness and fights? You keep blaming it on everything else. Cover that Thanksgiving dinner in prayer. Make the unification and thankfulness and cover it with something different than your cream cheese icing. I love it, but it ain't that all. And I'm not knocking, but I'm telling you that if God speaks to you, he speaks to you, that's okay. But I'm just saying we set ourselves up for all these distractions. We make our jobs and our careers the most important thing. Our status, our title, our position, all of that seems somehow far more important. But what we do is we rob God of a glory that belongs to him and alone. He will detest it. The second prophecy about pride is this: it will destroy you. Goes before destruction, Proverbs 16, 18 and 19. A haughty spirit before a fall. Better to be lowly in spirit along with the oppressed than to share plunder with the proud. God says to Obadiah, though you soar like an eagle and make your nest among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. See, pride destroys everything. See, pride destroys everything by doing this. Pride makes us fight against humility. Because what it does is it says, your humility is also your humiliation. And we despise the idea of the humiliation, so we reject the idea of becoming humble, even though he became humble. See, they say that he was led like a sheep before his shepherds. He was dumb. That he didn't open his mouth. He said not a single word. They stripped him naked and hung him on a cross, beat him. He had all power in his hand, and humility, he allowed himself to be humiliated. It's not about whether or not you get humiliated. It's about who you join in your humiliation. I want to be crucified with Christ, and nevertheless I want to live. Yet not I, but Christ who lives in me. But pride makes us think that somehow a humble heart is this horrible thing to have. So pride just starts to destroy everything. It destroys our relationship with our loved ones. Because we hold on to this position of strength as we watch the relationship fall apart. And we say like little thoughtful things like this. We say, I'm not perfect. We all make mistakes. Pride says, we all make mistakes. I'm not perfect. Humility says, I'm sorry. And there's a big difference between those two simple phrases. Humility says, I'm wrong. I'm sorry. I take this position, which I stand in need of forgiveness, where if I just say that, you know what, we all make mistakes. You just as bad as me. Pride destroys our relationships. Pride destroys our spiritual growth. Psalms 10:4. The wicked, through pride of his countenance, will seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. He will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. That's what happens with the wicked. Therefore, pride compasses them about as a chain. The pride weighs us down and locks us in and enslaves us to itself. Job 4:12. Look on everyone that is proud and bring him low and tread down the wicked in that place. Proverbs 29:23. A man's pride shall bring him low, but honor shall uphold the humble spirit. God's word demands that we find a place for humility in our lives. See, it's in his weakness that we are made perfect. Pride destroys everything. It destroys our relationships with God and with one another. And see, that's all it does. One of my favorite songs right now is a song that says, love God, love people. That's all it really is all about. Well, pride attacks that. It attacks this love of people and this love of God. That's what happens in the garden. It's an attack on the love of people and the love of God. See, Satan attacks the relationship that God has established as a perfect relationship, and he attacks the relationship that they have with God. And those two relationships is what he sought to corrupt. That's why your marriage is worth fighting for. That's why a relationship with your children is worth fighting for. That's why that sister or brother that you won't speak to is worth fighting for. You may think it's what they've done, but it's not that. It's for generations of pride that has sat in your heart. The third thing you need to know about pride is that it leads us to this selfish ambition. Leads to selfish ambition. James 3:16. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exists, there is disorder in every evil thing. But the wisdom from above is first pure and peaceful, gentle and reasonable, full of mercy and good fruits, unwavering and without hypocrisy. And the seed whose first fruits of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. See, the world is full of examples of men and women who have this incredible selfish ambition and pride. And I'm not talking about, well, just think about this. If you've, even sitting at home, if you've ever seen some extraordinary things, like pride gets into the heart. And it does these extraordinary things that are really built out of selfish ambition. So the best of athletes will cheat. The wealthiest of men will steal. The most powerful politicians will lie. All out of a selfish ambition that says, I've got to protect my brand, who I am. By it defines me. It sets me apart. And it may seem good to look at that high and lofty all on other people, but selfish ambition also does other things. It places upon our children a burden of doing something great, better. Because your failures are somehow my failures. They assign themselves to me. And although it is right that a man should lead his household properly and raise his children, and those are all right things, but when I start to lay upon other people a responsibility or burden that is mine, and what I say is now somehow you have lost control of an ambition that is inside of you, a desire to boast. Pride sets itself deep inside of us. It keeps us from going to the doctor because pride rejects wisdom. Pause for a commercial break to all my brothers. We will take our car to the mechanic, but we won't take our bodies to the doctor. We will take our car. Listen, y'all, some of y'all got it ready already. He done got the tires rotated, oil change, winter's coming. But you will not take your dizzy high blood pressure mind to the doctor. I ask you, what's your LDL? And you trying to tell me about a TV. No. I'm talking about bad and good. Pause for a commercial break. This is okay. Sisters, y'all can thank me later. Pride keeps us from forgiving because we hate peace. Pride keeps us from confessing because it despises mercy. Pride sets itself up in its self-ambition. And so when you ask yourself, why am I so impatient? Why am I so... All of those why am I questions you can ask yourself. And for all my young people, y'all know I'm hard on selfies. I don't have a problem maybe with selfies. I just want to be sure you understand why you're taking them. Just be sure you understand why. And I know they call it Instagram, but it ain't instant. It's instant there, but in your own mind, what you've done, the snapshot you thought of yourself, that and the reason I struggle with them is that I've seen the 47 photos you take, and only one of them is somehow a good enough image of you. Do you not know that the God who created you, made you in glory, and ordained you to be exactly who you are, the way you are, the way he wants you to be? And when you declare or reject something 47 times, well, Lord have mercy, what are you saying about yourself? Now, you can take a selfie. But if the pride in your heart rejects who you are, then turn it off. I dare you to fast from it for a week. I'm not playing. I mean, this thing is getting into our culture and our society and our way of acting and behaving. It's stepping into the church and we're not rejecting it. Not everything in the world belongs here. It's getting quiet in here. There's a story in the book of Matthew. It's the mother of the sons of Zebedee, Matthew 20. You can look at it. She comes to Jesus and she says, hey, Jesus, I need a favor. It's a little favor. Would you make my two sons, one to sit on your left and one to sit on your right, when you enter into your kingdom? Selfish ambition. Mama wants her baby boys to be on the left and the right of the Lord. Now listen, she will continue to grow and become deeply faithful to God. She'll be, they believe, at the cross on the crucifixion of Christ. But in this moment, she makes this fatal mistake of asking Jesus, and Jesus answers her. He says, listen. But Jesus answered, Do you not know what you're asking? Are you able to drink the cup that I am about to drink? And the son said to him, yes, we are. Okay. He says to them, well, my cup you shall drink, because they too will be crucified. But to sit on my right and left hand, this is not of mine to give, but it's for those for whom have been prepared by my Father. Hearing this, the other disciples get upset. But verse 26, Jesus says, listen, it is not this way among you, but whoever wishes to be great among you shall be a servant. Whoever wishes to be a servant shall be a slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. We talked a lot about the prophecy of pride. what will happen as a result of pride in our life. See, the thing is, we sometimes want God to do us a favor. God's favor is not something you ask for. God's favor is something you surrender to. Just understand that. It's not something you go asking God for. It's something you surrender your life to. So what he says to her is, and to them, you don't know what you're asking, but you're going to suffer with me. Yes, you are. But what you're going to need to do is you're going to have to surrender to me. God's going to set your place in the kingdom, but you're going to have to surrender. It's not something you go asking God for. It's something you got to surrender your life to. And so the answer for pride, for selfish ambition, you want to avoid destruction, well, you got to surrender. That's all. It ain't rocket science. I know. Listen, surrender. If Edom wanted out of being completely destroyed, all they had to do was surrender. But that surrender thing is hard. I think Paul makes it easier in the book of Philippians. He says, listen, in this story, he's talking about the divided nation, the challenge that happened between the original Jewish converts who have been circumcised, who are the sons of Abraham, as they would declare, and then of the new Gentiles who are being converted. And there's a struggle there because they were setting themselves as somehow, one, you need to be circumcised, and also that we're greater. They want to keep the caste system going, C-A-S-T-E, caste system going, in which I'm greater than you, you know? It's kind of like the American dream. We got a caste system here. We set one group above another. And we love it. That same thing was happening here. They were taking pride in themselves and their legacy. And listen, watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those manipulators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who are served God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ and who put our confidence in the flesh. And though I myself have reason for much confidence, if someone else were to think that they had a reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. See, Paul, I was circumcised on an eighth day. I am the people of Israel. I'm of the tribe of Benjamin. I am a Hebrew of Hebrews. In regard to the law, I'm a Pharisee. As for zeal, I persecuted the church. And as for righteousness, based on the law, I am faultless. So he declares, and listen, all that, bag of chips. I'm on fleek, as my kids would say. That over 50 crowd don't know what I'm talking about. But he says, but whatever was gained to me, I now consider lost for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything lost because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one which comes through faith in Christ Jesus. The righteousness that comes from God is on basis of faith. I want you to know Christ, yes, to know the power of the resurrection and participate in his suffering, becoming like him in death, and somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. The cure for pride is to lose yourself. I don't have any big solution. The word humble is not sufficient. It's not just to be humble before God. It is literally to lose yourself. It is an ongoing journey of becoming all the more humble, consistently laying pieces and parts of your life before God and saying, I want to lose all that I am. I want to count it all as garbage. I don't care about my house, my car, I want to lose all of that because I want to place my faith inside of you. And when I place my faith in you, then somehow I obtain something different. A righteousness that's no longer my own, a pride that has nothing to do with me. I'm like a Jesse Jackson crying like a baby because I see God doing something great. That's what you want your life to look like. The pride of a heart is one that surrenders itself to God completely. Paul goes on to say, he'll say, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press toward the mark for a prize of a higher calling that is in Christ Jesus. But then he has this 15th verse, he says, and we who are mature should take such a view of things. Problem with pride is the cure requires you to grow up. Pride is not for, fighting pride is not for the feeble-hearted. You're going to have to go through some stuff, suffer a little, meet some challenges, have some hard times. Surrendering to God is surrendering to his will and letting him take you on a journey that may be different than the one you want. And that's why Edom struggled. They struggled with the idea that they had to give up. We go back to the book of Obadiah. And if you're there, just open it up to the 15th verse. Obadiah 1:15. It's not on the screen. The 15th verse sets a little hinge in the passage. So the first half of the passage, the first 14 verses, just tell of destruction and the downfall of Edom and why. The 15th verse sets a hinge. One is about Edom, and now he moves into this prophetic phase in which he moves it to all nations, and it's why we find ourselves where we are today. For the day of the Lord draws near on all nations. As you have done, it will be done to you. For dealings will return to you on your head. He moves it from being about Edom, and he moves it to being about all nations. And when he moves it to this idea of all nations, it draws us into the prophecy and makes us a part of. Now, what are you saying? Well, he's saying, listen, you got to come along, and you better start to fight pride because you don't want to be like Edom. So I've given you a lesson, an object for you to look at. Now, you better act differently because the day of the Lord is coming, and I'm judging it all. The great thing about God when he sets a hinge, when he brings along with us from the beginning of time, from these big moments of grace. And so the 16th verse says, because just as you drank on the holy mountain, all nations will drink continually. They will drink and they will swallow and become as they have never existed. But on Mount Zion, there will be those who escape. And it will be holy, and the house of Jacob will possess their possessions. He gives us this big moment of hope in which he says, listen, the day is coming when this struggle won't exist. And I am 100% convinced that the pride of our hearts is the hardest thing for us to fight against. We can talk about all of it, but it's the hardest thing to fight against. Because by our very nature, we want to be successful. By our very nature, we want to be seen as better. By our very nature, even as Christians, we want to hold position and honor and want to achieve things on behalf of God. By our very nature, we want all those things. And God is saying, listen, but what I want you to do is give that up and humble yourself before me because I'm going to destroy that. And as you yield yourself to me, I've got a promise for you. One day. All of the challenges that go along with surrendering to me, I'm going to crack this sky. I'm going to bring it to an end, and we're going to all rejoice. One day, we're going to have church, and there won't be a need for pride because everyone's going to be focused on the one that matters most. One of these days, I'm going to change your heart once and for all. But in between, fight the fight. Surrender your life, and watch what I do. Let's pray. Eternal God, we love you for who you are and all the things you do in our lives. Lord, we thank you because great is your grace, so mighty is your hand. I pray for the person that does not know you today, Lord. The ultimate challenge of pride is to surrender your will into the need of salvation. To recognize that I need more than just a service. I need more than just a moment. I need the power of the Holy Spirit to indwell me. I need to be changed, transformed. I need to be renewed, made different. Lord, I pray that you would speak to that person today. And that you would cause them to surrender their life to you, Lord. It may seem that we're far away through technology and all those things. Doesn't matter. Wherever they are, you are in the room. So we pay by the power of your grace that you would speak to them. And the day they, Lord, would have the confidence to surrender their life to you. Let this be the day of salvation. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, wherever you are, in a moment, I'm going to just lead you in a simple prayer. At prayer is what we call the prayer of salvation. It's an expression of your faith in God, the surrendering of your life to God. You won't be caught off guard, that's for sure. God knows you. He has a plan for your life. This moment is about you accepting that plan and surrendering your will to God. So as I pray, if you would pray along with me, I just ask you to do that. Lord Jesus, I need you. I confess, Lord, that I'm a sinner, that I'm broken without you. Lord, would you come into my life and take control? Help me to live as you would have me to live. Father God, I believe this thing by faith. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today, we want to hear from you, please. Call us at 215-877-1530 and dial extension 2009. There, Pastor James, who heads up our evangelism ministry, he's going to reach out to you or someone from his team. Just to confirm and to care for you, to connect you to us. We don't want to miss this moment, so please, please call us. Pastor James or someone will be in touch with you. Hey, if you're in the church and you need prayer, we want to hear from you. We love you. We miss you. We want to be safe, but we also want to continue to care for you. And the power of prayer makes a difference. And so if you call the church, 215-877-1530, and you dial extension 1126, leave your message there. It's confidential line, and we will pray for you. We'll be praying for you, but please, please call. We want to pray for you. Now, we love you, and we thank you. Remember, love God and love people. Remember, Sunday school starts at 10:15. Just log in to the COVID update, and you'll be able to see it there. We continue to pray for you, and you continue to pray for the ministry. Continue to pray for Pastor Bell, Pastor Richardson, for all of our leaders. And we thank you for joining us. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, to the only wise God, be glory, dominion, power, here and forevermore. And all of God's people did say amen, amen, amen. God bless you. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Hey there. Thank you so much for worshiping with us today. We truly appreciate you joining us. We hope you were blessed, and we pray you join us again. Until next time, be healthy, be blessed, stay safe.